Hey, what's up, everyone? It's Catherine Morris, founder of Bands Fest. Welcome to, of course, Amplify the Soul this June 18th on a Friday night. We are extremely excited to have you all here tonight. We have an amazing performance from the only, the lovely, the queen, Kaovanny. We want to thank Eastern Bank for sponsoring this performance. It's been an amazing ride, and let's get it. Let's go. Let's get hype. I cannot wait for y'all to see this performance. So without further ado, Kaovanny.
I got into music, it's a funny story. I got into music by talking too much. In my second grade, my teacher, they were trying this new extracurricular activity, and which was chorus. And my teacher was like, Kaovanny, they didn't used to call me Kao back then. Kaovanny, if you don't be quiet, I'm not gonna let you participate in the new extracurricular activity. And I was like, what? I ain't staying in this classroom by myself. And surely enough, when I headed to that, I stayed quiet for the rest of the day, which was quite the challenge for my little second grade self. And I went to chorus, and from then on, I went home just singing John Jacob Jingleheimer Smith for the rest of the day, and the rest is history. I want my audiences to believe me when they see my performances or they hear my music. As an educator, I tell my kids in my music class all the time, it's so important to know yourself and to believe what you're saying, because a deaf person should be able to believe you by what you look like when you're performing, and a blind person should be able to believe you by what you sound like. Yes. And so if you don't believe yourself first, no one's gonna believe you.
Yeah. motion, yeah.
We don't have to leave.
judge me for my passion, love me unconditional. I know I could be difficult, but when I take you out your comfort zone, need it unconditional. I'm trying to stay vulnerable. We don't have to be here if we stay. We don't have to leave.
My life inspires my creative process very much. My life. Everything I talk about is testimony. It's either mine or someone that I love dearly. And so I think it's important that after we die, we can, or after we leave this place, you know, however you want to define it, that the things that we went through still ring true. Out in, even if it's just in the air for no one to hear, it's always gonna find an ear of someone who's been through that before. And I think that we don't go through things for just ourselves. I think we go through things to testify and to help someone else get through that same exact thing, because we're just always going through cycles and we're always learning things. And so, yeah.
Hey, what's up, everyone? First of all, we just need to give a round of applause for that amazing performance by the lovely Queen Goddess Mother Earth, Kaovanny. Okay, it is on and popping. We are truly excited tonight to just reflect, just like, you know, be in the now with the lovely Kaovanny. So, Kao, hello. How are you?
Hello, Catherine. I'm honored, like I told you before we got on here, I'm honored that I get the amazing Catherine Morris as my host tonight. So I'm chilling. I'm gassed. I'm gassed right now.
Well, let me tell you something. It's always a pleasure to just be in conversation with super dope, amazing artists that we love and continue to support. You know, even in times of COVID, we know that things are rough and tough, but you did it. You know, the content's out there. Everyone's out there. They're seeing you. They're showing love. And that's where it starts, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely.
Well,
it was nerve-wracking. I already know.
Oh, I know. But we've overcome, right? So that's the most important thing. And I think for, like, viewers, for all the fans out there, I know it's been rough. It's been an interesting, you know, 14, 15 months. And I'm curious, like, how has the past year been for you in creating, just being a person, being a human being? How's it been for you?
It's been different every day. Legit. Like, every time someone asked me how I was doing, it was a different answer every time. And so I think that I learned to flow like water. And I also learned within the past year that I'm a Scorpio rising. And so I learned to cooperate with the water in my existence and kind of just, and also be still, ironically, because when I think of water, at least I think of movement. I feel like water never stops moving. But I was kind of with the water that learned how to be still. And so that's what this year brought me in a nutshell.
Gotcha. Sorry, you're totally hearing my three-year-old right now.
Oh, no. It was just totally okay. Hey, boo.
He'll make his appearance. No worries. It's interesting you talk about, you know, being still, right? And I believe that in that stillness, you learn a lot, as you've talked about. You know, for those who don't know you, and I've gotten a little bit, you know, given part of the interviews that have been interwoven into the performances, but like, for those who don't know you, like, about your roots, how did music find you, or how did you find music? Curious.
So music, I think the best term is to say music found me over and over and over again. And I'm the type of person that, I guess my priority, I just learned why it's so, and I'm not going to dig into it because then I'm going to go back into the whole astrology thing of things. But it's interesting the way that I exist in our industry, because I want to be heard and not seen, but you kind of have to be seen in our industry to move anywhere. Yeah. And so it's interesting because music kind of chases me every single time. Every single time I try to walk away, I go through another transformation, like initiation almost, where I have this art in me that just, I can't just let it die. It has to come out. And God, through the angels around me and the people that God has put in my life, there's been a constant movement in music. Like, there's always an opportunity, there's always a job, there's always a mission, a goal, something for me to be doing somewhere. And so every single time I try to walk away, it was like, no, girl, you're not doing it. You gotta be here. You have to do this. And God knows exactly who to use to get us to bust a move. And so music found me through, y'all heard the story, how it started in the second grade, but then it was nurtured through my youth center that I grew up in. It was called Hope Street Youth Center, and it is now Movement City Youth Center, Lawrence, Massachusetts. I was born and raised in Lawrence, Mass. I'm
all
a
right,
first generation.
Yeah,
978. Look, the hood came out real quick. 978. No, I'm just playing, but not really. But yeah, so I feel like I'm very, very grateful for Lawrence. I resented it for some time, but I feel like I've grown out of that time, because when I think about anywhere else that I could have been raised in Massachusetts and be exposed to the art that I was exposed to that got me to where I am now, like, there's no other place that I could have been that would have nurtured me the way that I was nurtured at Hope Street Movement City Youth Center. And so, that's kind of, by being a part of a youth center and being in community, I had no choice. Every single time somebody came to the center, it was like, "Kale, sing something." So like, stage fright wasn't a thing. Like, it was just a constant community. It was a pumping machine all the time of creativity, and everyone around me was constantly creating. And I see some Movement City people in the chat. Shout out to Harvey. Shout out to my sister Gita. And Misael Martinez, who is the founder of Hope Street. And, yeah.
I love it. That's what's up. I mean, you bring up a point how important, you know, youth centers are in the development of human beings. Like, that's super duper important right now. And we need them. We need more of them. So I'm glad that they found you, and I'm glad you found them, and that you have truly blossom, and that even when you were trying to figure out, you know, what your path was going to be, you kind of just, you know, followed it where it was going to take you, which has gotten you to such a beautiful point in your life. And I'm wondering, actually, you know, just hearing your story and where you are now, as we're coming through COVID, as we're coming through a racial pandemic, as we're coming through, you know, all kinds of things, you know, what are the things that you're able to do to take care of yourself first before being an artist? Because I think that's crucial, even as a person who creates. I believe that everyone has a regimen. So I'm curious, even for the audience, like, how do you take care of yourself?
I take care of plants. And my plants hold me accountable because they're a huge energy check. And if your energy is not in check, your plants aren't in check either. Your plants start to die. They start to show how much you're not in check because they can feel your energy. They feel your energy through the water that you use to water them. They feel your energy in the room that you, like, this is my room, and you can see I have all these plants around me. And so the place that I feel that has the most concentrated Kaovanny energy is my room. And so however I'm fed, it will directly impact everything in my environment. And so these plants are living constantly feeding off of you, not even just when you water them. And so whenever I'm stressed, my roommates know, because I'm putting my hands in dirt. I'm doing something. I'm repotting something. I'm trimming something. I'm figuring something out with my plants. Like, okay, I'm grounding right now. And like, I get my hands in it. I get dirt all in my nails. I'm in it all day if I could be. If I have nothing else to do, don't bother me. I'm rearranging my plants for no reason, but all the reasons at the same time. So my self-care is definitely in my plants because they're the best energy check somebody could have.
I'm curious, because you mentioned plants, right? Like, it's all about the living material we surround ourselves with, right? Is there a particular plant that you gravitate towards?
You know, no. Well, yes, actually, if I'm going to be real with you, every time I go into the plant shop, yeah. Like, I leave with a plant every single time. Whichever one calls me that day, Catherine, yes. but no, every single one of my plants has a different story. My Monstera has, yeah, they all have a different story. So no, there's not one particular one that I love for whatever reason, but one calls me. So to answer your question, one calls me every single time I hit the plant shop. Yeah. Absolutely.
Well, good to know. If I see you in a plant shop, I'm like, all right, there is something much more metaphysical going on there, because clearly you're in your zone. That's super dope. Wow, that's awesome. All right, for those who need to get a little bit more oxygen and surround yourself with living material, get yourself a plant. That is important in life. You never know. Mm-hmm. And it does hold you accountable, because, you know, if your plant goes dead, that says a lot about you. So shout out to all the folks who take care of plants. You know, for those that have never experienced, you know, Bands Fest, I'm curious, Kaovanny, what has been your first Bands Fest experience? What can you remember?
I remember, I think it might have been the last one before COVID, or could have been the one. No, it wasn't. It couldn't have been the one before that. It was the one right before COVID, I believe, when Eric Roberson was performing.
Yes, 2019.
Yes, and I didn't know who he was with all the other songs he was singing, but then he started singing "Mark on Me," and I was like, oh my God, I know who this man is. Like, all of a sudden I'm with the program. Like, I was just, you know, flowing in the lawn, saying what's up to everybody. And then he starts singing this song and I start running to the stage like a little fan. Like, I didn't care. And then all of a sudden I'm like, I know you. You left a mark on me like an idiot. But that Bams Fest was lit because I saw DJ Ropi there. I saw Oompa there. I saw so many black creatives outside chilling, like looking dope, and it was just it was cool. It was a shift from the Beantown Jazz Festival for sure, and but it was a different experience, and it just felt more at home for sure. So my first BAMS Fest Fest experience was dope. Oh, and there was people at Bamf Fest wearing Kaovanny t-shirts. So shout out to those people, because people were hitting me up like, yo, you here? Before I even got there, people were like, yo, are you here? Are you here? This dude over here with your t-shirt on. This is shorty over here with your t-shirt on. And I was like, what the heck is going on? So it was dope. It was a lot of support, and I wasn't even performing that year. It was a lot of Black creatives. It was, the weather was beautiful. DJ Ro P was doing his thing, and you already know when he spins, it's a wrap. So shout out to
Ro P. Of course. That's what's up.
Yeah, that was my first BAMS Fest, my first and only so far. Well, this is my second, but that was my first BAMS Fest experience, and it was.
We got many more to come. Don't worry about it. We got so much more things in store. I'm curious, you know, when we're talking about memories, you know, what ultimately, when it's all said and done, what's the legacy you want to leave with your music, with your art, period?
I just want to tell the truth. I'm working real hard to release myself constantly. I'm working, affirming myself to release myself from people's opinions of me, so that I can continue to move as freely as possible. And I just want my freedom to inspire people to do just that, because I just feel like about having someone have their foot on our neck can come from so many angles, way more than just one. And sometimes we put our own foot on our own neck, and I fight me first, and then I fight everyone else. To be as free as I can. And so I people tell me that when they watch me, they get inspired to be free as well. And so I want to continue doing that. Like, that wasn't even originally my goal. I wanted to educate. Like, I'm an educator, and I like to educate in my life as well. But when people told me that my freedom makes them free, I'm like, oh, I got to make that a priority as well. Like, that is a part of education as well, educating people to be free. Whatever that means for you, or whatever it is that you need to release to feel that. I guess that's not, I guess, I lied. I know that's the legacy that I want to be. So.
That's what I'm talking about. I mean, liberation of the mind is the most freeing thing we could ever do. So I think you've totally summed that up. That makes absolute unapologetic sense in general. What's coming up for you? What are projects? What are shows? Like, what is the next 6 months looking like for you?
I'm dropping a project within the next 6 months called Agua Caoba, and I'm really excited about it. This is the first time I mention it out loud. But before that project even drops, there's a single, which is a project in itself, that I have come together with my Miso Brown team and family to curate. And the visuals are crazy. The song, you guys just heard it. That's the song that I just performed. This was the debut of War Cry, by the way. That's the name of the song. Nice. That was the first time that I've showed it live to people. I forgot to mention that. But War Cry is unreleased, and it's going to drop at the end of the month or top of July. Stay in touch with my social media so y'all will know. We'll have the rollout out soon. I keep kaovanny.com updated so y'all will know through that. But yeah, that's pretty much it. I'm trying to listen to my body with what I want to do with this COVID trauma, because I'm not sure I'm ready to like just go back to regular old gigging. But for those of you who have been rocking with me pre-COVID, I do want to find a way to bring back Noche Mahogany, whether it be outside, you know, we can get some space to shake our booties freely and sweat somewhere this summer. Look out for that. So that I'm trying to bring Noche Mahogany back. But yeah, live performance, Catherine, is my favorite thing in the whole wide world. So my priority, I want to find a way to bring that back and feel safe doing it. I don't want to be hyperventilating because I'm out in the streets surrounded by people, because I haven't addressed my COVID trauma, but I definitely will be out there outside somewhere this summer. So look for that. So War Cry drops and Agua Caoba will drop some point within the next 6 months. And that's what I got going on. It's been wild. I've been in the Dominican Republic for half of the year that we've had so far. And that was a transforming spiritual experience. and a lot of that is going to be in my new project. So I'm excited for that.
Wow. You're super busy.
Am I?
Like, super. As you're talking, I'm like, wow, okay. I look forward to the next 6 months, quite honestly.
You know, that's funny you say that, because I actually feel like I've been resting more than ever.
It's to prepare you for, you know, bigger platforms. At the end of the day, it's to prepare you for whatever the next chapter you're getting ready to write. So I'm glad that you got your rest. Continue to rest. That's always crucial as an artist. But you know, when your spirit's ready, it will. Your hand will hit the pad. Like, I'm not even worried about that at all.
I
salute you for that. It's not easy. I mean, I think as audience members, we take certain things for granted. Creating from scratch constantly is a lot. Mm-hmm. It takes a lot of energy, and I have nothing but utmost respect for you all, because I could never be in your shoes. All I can do is consume it and love it and wear it and tell my other friends about it. So I salute y'all. I salute you completely.
You're doing exactly what you're supposed to be doing, because guess what? I don't do what the heck you be doing, all right? And all these people together to do what you do. So shout out to all the roles that need to be played in this grand scheme of things.
I appreciate you. No doubt. I have some rapid fire questions. So I'll give you two options and you will respond which one. All right, you ready?
No, but let's do it.
All right, here we go. On the stage or in the studio?
On the stage, that's easy.
Okay. Writing or singing?
Writing.
Told you it's not gonna be easy. That's all
right. That's low key right in the middle. That's low key right in the middle, but writing.
Oh, you just gotta go either way, you know. It's fine. joy or peace?
Oh my God, they're both so important. What kind of questions are these, Catherine?
Spitfire, come on, people are waiting now.
Okay. Peace.
Travel or stay at home?
Travel.
Okay. Lauryn Hill or Jill Scott?
Lauryn Hill. I don't even have to think about it. You could literally compare it to anyone. It is always going to be L Boogie.
Well, let me tell you something. I am so honored to have this conversation with you. It's my hope that everyone enjoyed your performance. For those that don't realize that we do not release the videos even to the artist. So all this you're getting is a first natural reaction to the performance, their own performance. And we do that on purpose. So, because we know people can be their worst critic. It's just, hey, you get to experience it like everyone else. So just thank you, KO. I know you love me. I just want to thank everyone for joining us tonight. Please share this performance. We are doing some amazing things with Boston artists, Boston-based artists. Thank you to Eastern Bank for sponsoring this performance. We couldn't have done it without you. And thank you to the audience for just being a part of this journey. And we look forward to seeing you at the next performance. So thank you, KO. We love you. And thank you so much. Let's go.
Yes, thank you. Thank you so much for having me, Ben Stress. You guys are amazing. I'm excited for all of this.
Absolutely. You got it. Cool. All right, let's go. Let's conclude.